was obviously in politics for a number of years, almost 10 years, and spoke to thousands of people and, you know, big groups and little groups. Excuse me a second. Thank you. But this is different. When you write a book and you kind of, especially a book like this, where you kind of put yourself out there, you don't know if people are even going to read it or respond to it. And to get the kind of response that I've gotten from this book, and I'm sorry, we don't have any books to sell. Usually, either Barnes & Noble, they come to these events or they give us a case of books to come and sell. And I didn't think of it. She called this morning or this afternoon to go get a case of books, and the Waterfront's sold out. They're on order. South Hills Village had just a handful, so I'm sorry, we don't have any books to sell, and but I'm sure they'll have them back in stock again, or you can always just buy them online at BarnesandNoble.com or Amazon or Google Books or Walmart. You know, everyone sells them, so. But back to what I was saying, I'm always very humbled to come and talk, that people have, you know, responded and taken the time to read this book and to recognize, you know, I put 7 years into this. You know, it took me five months to write the book and then another 6 or 7 years to actually get it published. To figure out the publishing world and to get to, you know, one of the largest publishers in the world, Penguin, Random House, sell the book to them, and they published it. So that was my goal. We have a couple television programs that are scheduled, and one that's done that will air internationally later this year. Another one, Discovery, is just working on, and we're talking to movie people all the time. I have an agent in New York that's handling that. If they work out a deal, fine. If they don't, then they don't. My goal was to write this book and to tell this story. I'd like to, you know, make it clear starting out, you know, I'm the last person that I've never in the world thought if I was going to write a book. You know, I'm a historian, amateur historian. I've written for his historical periodicals and so on about George Washington, and that's my interest. And if I'm going to write a book, I always thought I'd write a book about history. Never in my wildest dreams did I ever think I'd write a book about this stuff, you know. I was never a ghost hunter. I never had any interest in this stuff. I still don't. I don't watch the movies, The Conjuring, or I don't want anything to do with this stuff, believe me. You know, we get requests all the time. I talk to paranormal groups and so on, but I never was into that. Not that I have anything against it. I think people shouldn't treat this as a hobby, because it can be a very dangerous hobby if you get in and get involved with the wrong spirits, so to speak. You know, I grew up like many of you. I saw The Exorcist when I was a teenager, maybe the Amityville Horror, so had no experience with ghosts or goblins or anything like that. And why and how we ended up, you know, in the middle of what we experienced. Was there some kind of divine providence involved? I've been told that possibly there was, because this is a story that needs to be told. How many people have read the book? Okay? That's usually the case. You know, people come to know, find out what it's about. Well, this book, you know, say, well, that's a haunted house. It's a haunted house, scare me to death kind of book. That's not the purpose of this book. Certainly, when you read it, it's bizarre. It really freaks you out as to what happened and what we went through. And, you know, even as I had to write it and rewrite it and rewrite it through the whole editing process, it kind of never lost its edge with me as I was going through it. but I didn't design it to be a paranormal book or a scare me to death book. This book is different because I believe in the end, it either reaffirms what you believe about good and evil, God and the devil, and your perspective of the divine and the almighty and the supernatural, whether you believe that or not, or if you don't believe that, I think it forces you to make a decision. And I read one review on Amazon. All the guy wrote was, this is a tough book for an atheist because it forces you to make a decision. And the way I designed this book, and I was very, very vigilant through the writing process, and I worked with a professional writer, I still wrote the book, but and the editor, and I made sure that this book was not presented as a scary, just paranormal book. I was very protective of the main premise and theme of this book, that good and evil, that God and the devil, that angels and demons are real. It's real. And that, let me get my train of my thought process back again. That evil exists apart from evil intentions of people, whether they be, you know, mentally crazed people or so on, and someone gets a, you know, an AK-47 and goes into a kindergarten and starts shooting a place up. Or as you see on TV or on the internet, you have a bunch of these nuts in black hoods lining up 25 people and cutting their heads off simultaneously. That's evil, evil, evil. Charles Manson, evil. You know, the Nazi regime or a whole country, sophisticated, intelligent country, within a matter of years was, you know, taking 6 million people and putting them in ovens. That's not flawed personalities. That's evil. It exists. And it causes people to do evil things just as God and his angels influence us to do good things. And I talk in the book about the movie The Matrix. For those of you who have seen the movie The Matrix, that there's this, we're here, but there's this whole unseen world around us. We're at the center of it, and there's like, and we don't fully understand the significance of the world that we're in. Well, I can tell you that if you know your Bible, when Satan was cast out of heaven by God and St. Michael the Archangel, Satan was cast out with one third of his angels who became demons, and they weren't cast into hell. Cast down to the earth, and that's where they are, and that's where they've been. And Satan is called the prince and the power of the air, and he and his evil, they're around us all the time, just like good is. So why am I saying all this? Because for whatever reason, we experience one of those demons, and I was up close and personal with it. I mean, it was like living with the invisible man. I mean, I knew this thing. And when you have one foot in the supernatural and one foot in the physical world, you know, over a period of a couple of years, we're not talking about a week, we're not talking about, you know, going outside and seeing a flying saucer or something, you know. No, this is something that we lived with day in, day out, week in, week out, for 2 years. And you get done, and I'm saying, this was just so bizarre, and I kept copious notes through the whole thing, and I said, I have to tell this story. I have to tell people that this is all real, and I wanted to do it in a way that laid it all out in an understandable, in a straightforward way that isn't sensational, and tell the story. So, before I get to that story, I'll tell you one quick experience I had. I was at a Barnes & Noble book signing back last summer, and a young woman about 23 years old came up to me, and as I was signing her book, she said, you know, What impressed me most about this book wasn't what you went through. And that, I perked up at that. She said, what impressed me was your faith in God. Because I have no faith, she said. You know, I grew up in a family, we never talked about church, we never went to church, we never talked about God. It just wasn't part of our lexicon. It wasn't part of what, it just didn't exist. So your book, I bought it because I thought it was a haunted house story, and I found God in it. I didn't bargain for that. And she said, it's changed the whole way I look at life now. And I'm still not reconciled with the message of your book. And I said, you're the reason I wrote the story. I think there's so many young people like that now. You know, a couple generations, people don't go to church anymore. You know, the kids don't go to church. They have no concept, anything about God. Nothing. And, you know, we're older, but I mean, a lot of 20-year-olds have no concept. I was working out at the gym here a few months ago, and there's a big, strong, muscle guy that I work out when he's there in the gym always with me, and he cut his hair real short, and I said to him, hey, Tyson, watch out. You know what happened to Samson when he cut his hair? And he looked at me and he said, who's Samson? Now, most of us know who Samson is, right? I think. I said, you do know who Noah is, right? Yeah, I've heard of Noah. But, you know, young people just don't have any concept of good and evil, of God, and so hopefully through this, the message of this book is Jesus Christ and the power of his sacrificial death on the cross. And I don't preach it. I'm not trying to convert anyone through this story. I just tell the story. And I say what worked and what prevailed eventually over this evil. So that's the story. I'll get into it here in just a moment and talk for 40 minutes or so and take questions. So, you know, I'm still very concerned about myself and my family after writing this book. And I don't think God's going to put us out on a limb or put me out on a limb defenseless. But, you know, a book like this is like writing a book about the mob. And the mob's not happy when they're out it. And I'm sure when evil is unmasked and the devil is unmasked, and the more and more publicity this gets and more television programs and, you know, I'm interviewing all over the country and I've had interviews in England and evil will stand up and take notice. And so I pray. And I pray the rosary a lot. And that was a big part of the story. Okay, so let's get into it a little bit for those who haven't read the book. And I'll tell you a thumbnail sketch of what the book's about, and then hopefully if you want, buy it, and you can get the rest of the details. I grew up in Brentwood on Brownsville Road. Most of you are probably familiar with Brentwood and Brentwood Park, and the house is right on Brownsville Road, a block down from the entrance to Brentwood Park. It was built in 1909. It's a historic landmark because of its unique architecture. Was built by Landau Construction, the same commercial builder that built South Hills Village and Whitehall Shopping Center and their stone business, and still doing very well. They built five houses back in the turn of the century, a couple of which I think are in Bethel Park. They determined that houses weren't their forte, so they focused on commercial properties, but our house was one of the houses that they did build. You know, I grew up in Brentwood, went to Brentwood High School, graduated from Duquesne University in 1978, commissioned a second lieutenant in the Army, and couldn't wait to get away from Pittsburgh, as many people couldn't back in the 70s and 80s, and was commissioned and went on to what I thought would be a 30-year career as a military intelligence officer. And, you know, the funny thing about Pittsburgh is, though, once you leave Pittsburgh, you know, you can't wait to come back. So, and most people want to come back to visit. But after about 7-8 years in the military and 3 children at the time, and I was looking at a 4-year assignment in Europe, in Berlin. That's before the wall fell. And my wife and I sat down, we were in Northern Virginia at the time, and he said, you know, is this what we really want to do with the, you know, the next 20, 25 years of our life, is move around the world every 3 years? And I would have gone to, you know, through a number of wars as well. and we said, what do we want? So, you know, we put all the pros, all the cons, and we totaled it all up and said, what we'd like is to, you know, to give our kids the same type of upbringing that I had, that you had, you know, live in the same house, go to the same school, have the same friends. And so we wanted to live in Pittsburgh. So we set that as our goal, made a big career change, left a great career. Certainly was not able to move right home to Pittsburgh in the 1980s, but luckily I got a nice job with AT&T in New Jersey with the idea that hopefully at some point I would be able to transfer to Pittsburgh. And we were surprised after 8 months in building a new house out there. I did get a great job here in Pittsburgh down in the steel building, and in 1988 the company bought our house out east, and we came back to Pittsburgh with a pocket full of money and a nice job, and we were happy. Now, we were intending on, if you live out in the South Hills, you don't move to the North Hills, so we were looking to move to either Bethel Park or South Park, and we were looking at homes in that, or my wife had come home early to look at homes, and I finished up in New Jersey saw the packing and the moving and so on. My wife had just had our 4th child in October of 1988. So I come home, and we're going to look at houses, and my mother says to me, oh, by the way, I just got a telephone call the other day, and your house is going up for sale. Now you might say, well, what do you mean, your house? Well, since I had memory and could walk the streets as a little boy, and back then, a little boy at 6 or 7 years old could go out and walk around, not like today. So this house always intrigued me. There wasn't a time when I was a kid, a teenager, or adult, I couldn't stop and stare. This house just reached out to me. And I was always so infatuated and intrigued by this thing, I just wanted to go into it. And there was just something mystical about it. It's kind of weird. To the point where my mother was confident enough in saying, your house is going up for sale. She knew I knew exactly, and I said, get out. You know, you're kidding. She said, yeah, they talked to me. They haven't put it on the market yet. She was a retired real estate broker, and they wanted to ask her who they should list it with. And she said, well, you don't have to list it at all, because I know I have a buyer for it. And she did. Now, so we go to this house in late October of 1988, and, you know, I must have been nuts. I mean, big 3-story, no insulation. We had enough furniture maybe for the first floor, you know, for a third of the house. It's one of, you know, I grew up in a standard Pittsburgh 3-bedroom, 2-story, salt box house like most of us are familiar with. You go in one of these old turn-of-the-century houses, you know, the Victorian era with the big, with all the woodwork and the 10-foot ceilings and the big rooms, and I mean, you walk in and it just kind of takes your breath away. You're not used to that. And it just was so impressive as we went in, and I looked around, and you know, you walk into the foyer of the house, and you know, it's not as big as I'm sure some of the big ones over in Friendship or Squirrel Hill, but needless to say, it was big enough. The big foyer and big staircase and wraparound balcony from the 2nd floor that looks down, and the servant's staircase that goes to the 3rd floor, and the servant's bell, which was still there you know, with the button in the dining room where you would call the maid or the waitress or whoever that came to, you know, serve food, all that kind of neat stuff. All the woodwork was still intact, pocket doors, all that. And being a historian, I was just so intrigued with it. It was everything I thought it would be as I came into it. And I just thought, wow, you know, people were here the night the Titanic sunk. And when World War I started, and World War II, and the Depression, and the stock market crash, and all that stuff, all that history, which is here, and it just was great. Now, as I said, 100-year-old house made out of stone and wood with no insulation. I could see why they had kerosene heaters throughout the whole place. When we went down and we looked at the furnace, which was still the original furnace that they had put in when they converted it from coal. It was so big. I used to joke with folks that, you know, when I turn this furnace off in the spring, they have to lay, if Columbia Gas has to lay people off. or I have to tell them when I'm going to turn it on so they're prepared for the, you know, the drop in pressure in their lines. So it was just, it wasn't realistic that we would buy a house like that. But as I said, it was just something that was like predestined. And so we went there, and, you know, there was no question. Any other house that we were going to look at that was on our list was off the list. It was the end of the list. That was the list. And my wife, you know, she didn't know what was up, really. You know, okay, this is a house you like. It's pretty big. If you think so, you know, looks like it's a lot of work. So we went in, and you know, when you make an offer on a house, the people seemed real anxious. The woman was almost angry that she was leaving. She wanted to leave, but she didn't want to leave. She was like angry that we were there to look at her house, to buy it. And it was a strange dynamic. So I'm thinking, I had an idea of what they wanted. I know how much money we had. You know, when you make an offer on a car or a house, especially on a house, you think, okay, so how much we have. So I have probably $20,000 or $25,000 more than I'm going to offer, so I have room to go up because they're going to say no, it's not enough. So I made my first offer, almost embarrassed to make the offer without insulting them, and I was kind of flabbergasted when the guy put out his hand and said, "Okay, so we'll take it. When can you move in?" So that was kind of interesting. We're looking through the house. We go back, and, you know, we were there a number of times after we made the deal, and you go back for the closing and everything. But we were there at one point, and they were showing us all the, you know, all the ins and outs of the house, giving us a tour. I guess it was the first time we were there, and they had spent 9 years there. The previous owners had been there for 40 years, and I don't know how long the woman was there as a widow. Her husband had died, and there was a lot of work. These folks had spent about 9 years doing a lot of, like, dirty work, like fixing plaster ceilings that had fallen down and changing wiring and plumbing. They didn't change the furnace, which I wish they would have, or the windows. How many windows are in it? 44 or 46. 46 windows. Maybe because we didn't change a couple of them. So almost 50. I mean, these windows, some of them, I can't even stretch my arms out is how big these windows were. So we were down in the basement. We had our two oldest children with us, our daughter who was 4 and our son who was 3, me and Lisa and the two, I call them the McHenrys in the book. That's a fictitious name. And Lisa looked around and said, "Where's Bobby?" 3-year-old boy. And
I don't know, where's he at? So she looked around and asked Jessica, and she said, I don't know where he's at. So they turn around, Lisa turned around. My wife's in the back too, by the way, that's who I'm pointing to. Oh, you saw her come up here. They head upstairs to find her. Her and the woman and Mrs. McHenry. And then we went up afterwards, just right behind them, and they rushed up and they heard him like hyperventilating. A little three-year-old, you can imagine. He was in the front of the house, halfway up the stairs. There's a landing halfway up, and then the stairs go in the other direction. And he was shaking and hyperventilating. And the woman rushed out, Mrs. McHenry, in front of Lisa and embraced him and said, oh, honey, what's wrong? Did you see something? What did you see? And Lisa thought, what do you mean, what did he see? You know, that was kind of another red flag, kind of a strange question. And, oh, you'll be okay, you'll be okay. So, you know, after that, we left, and she said to me, you know, this, I know you love this house, but I don't know, this place kind of gives me the creeps, and I can't put my finger on why or how, but I just don't feel comfortable with this house. It feels like, you know, it's sucking us in or letting us in. And I said, oh, it's your imagination. You know, once we get in and get our furniture and so on and make it our home, it'll be fine, don't worry. But I had to, you know, silently, you know, admit to myself, I kind of had the same feeling. So probably the next time we went back, I was in the kitchen, and I asked Mr. McHenry this question. I said, listen, Jim, is there anything wrong with this house? That's just the way I said it. Is there anything wrong with this house? And you would think he would come back with a retort, and he would say, well, what do you mean? Clarify what you mean, wrong. What, the roof, the furnace, the plumbing? But he didn't do that. He said, our house is fine. In fact, we've had mass in the living room twice. Two of my sons had their first communion in the living room. They were obviously Catholic. And I thought, okay. Now, I was raised Catholic. We were not Catholic at the time. I had left the church, and my wife was raised Methodist. And I thought, well, this is kind of weird. Who has mass in their living room? And furthermore, who has their first communion? First communion is a big deal. It's Mother's Day, you know. It's not something you do. You can't arrange to have your own first communion in your living room. You do that in church. And furthermore, who has mass in their house? You know, Mass is celebrated, it's a sacred event in a Catholic church, and unless it's extenuating circumstances like a war or something, it's not something they like take on the road. But nonetheless, they did. And years later, when we had Mass, you know, in that living room and multiple bedrooms and in the attic and in the basement, and all my four of my kids had their first communions because they weren't Catholic. In our living room, I understood the significance of what he had said, because I would later find out that Mass is an integral part of the church's confrontation of evil or the cleansing of a house that's infested. So I understood that years later. At the time, I didn't. There were also a number of other red flags. I worked, as I said, downtown, and I was proud of this house, and I was talking to a guy that worked with me, and in fact, he lived in Bethel Park. His name is Bob Wunderlich. I don't know if he still does or not, but he said to me, you bought the haunted house. I said, what do you mean I bought the haunted house? Now, I already knew by that time we had issues. I'll tell you about why I knew, but this is like January of 1989. We moved in December of 88. He said, well, back during the Depression, my father lived on Bookman Avenue, which is right over the hill from where that house is, and it was empty in the late 1930s, and it was. The people just about lost it for taxes, and it was repossessed. But it was empty, and he said, my father and his friend were young boys, and they some way got inside that house, and they were chased out of it by something. Now, what that was or what happened, I didn't ask them to pontificate or clarify it, but that was just another red flag, another indicator that we had issues. Later that spring, I was in the front yard planting flowers out at the end of the driveway, and you know, just petunias and my shovel hit something metallic in the ground. It was right at the corner of the edge of the property, and I dug up a little metal box. And as I can recall, it's a Sucrets box. Remember Sucrets throat lozenges? And it wasn't old. It like hadn't been there for 20 years or anything. It was still relatively new. And you know, I opened it up. And this is what I pull rosaries out of it. And then there was a scapular in there too. Now, we had already, you know, this other stuff had already happened, and I said, this is ridiculous, you know. So I went and called up Mr. McHenry on the phone. They had only moved a few blocks away on Stewart Avenue. And I said, hey, Jim, I just dug up a metal box in the front yard that has rosaries in it. Can you enlighten me a little bit? Do you know anything about these? And it was silent. And he said, just put them back, please. Just put them back right where you found them. And that's all I have to say. Okay. So, it was very clear to me that with the, or it's very, it became very clear that, you know, they had experienced issues. I would later talk to an older woman who grew up there as a young girl in the 1940s and into the 50s, and she told me the things that they had experienced. But, you know, with that, with the rosary beads, with the mass thing, it shed some light on our first encounter with the paranormal, the supernatural. On January of 89, we were, you know, it was wintertime. I'm going to work. I'm putting an overcoat on. There's a big walk-in closet underneath this large oak wooden staircase. Walk-in closet, storage closet, big thing, you know, coats. And in that closet, there's a light. It almost looks like an old gas light. The house had gas lights when it was first built. And it comes out, pipe comes out of the wall, and the light faces down towards the floor. It has an ornamental shade on it. And, you know, a normal, regular little pull chain. So you open up the closet, reach in where the light is, find the chain, pull it, turn on the light. You can't generally see it in right away because your eyes have to adjust. But after I had been there a week or so, I noticed every time I would go to that closet to turn the light on, I could never find the chain initially. And I would have to get in there, and the chain would either be wrapped completely around the pipe, or most often, it would be very meticulously wrapped around one of the little screws that would hold in the shade. So either the chain wasn't there, or when you did find it, it wouldn't pull down. So I think, okay, well, you know, I didn't do it, and you know, whose fault it was. So I went to my wife, and I said, please, Lisa. She kept the vacuum cleaner in that closet. I said, well, you get the vacuum, and you Don't just pull the chain and let it fly, because it's flying around the light itself, and it's getting tangled up there. It's aggravating. So just pull the chain and gently. And you know what she said? I know how to turn a light off and on. And furthermore, I haven't even been in that closet this week. I said, okay, well, I know I'm not crazy. So one morning, I'm going to work. It's 7:30 in the morning or so, 7 o'clock in the morning, and we're standing, the light's on. I said, okay, this is the deal. You turn the light off, close this door, don't you open it for the rest of the day. Now, our kids are 4, 3, 2, and a newborn,
And, you know, this light is up, you know, it's 5 feet off the floor. They're not going to mess with it anyway. I mean, they were too young to even think about doing anything, you know, mischievous like that. So, naturally, I come home that night, open up the door, reach in. She's with me, because this is like a test. Let's see what happens. Open the door. It's wrapped around. It's wrapped around one of the little screws. So with that, seemingly, you think that's okay. Well, it's no. Yeah, it was a big deal because we didn't do it, and I know that little brass chains don't float in the air. So we knew right then and there. And I had already had this conversation with the guy at work telling me I bought the haunted house and hadn't done the rosaries in the yard yet, but I remembered what McHenry had told me. So we came to the conclusion more and more because every day that chain did the same thing. I finally took a piece of wire, tied it to the chain, a couple knots, and took it over to a coat hook and tied it to the coat hook so it wouldn't move. Later on, that wouldn't have made any difference. It would have broken the wire. But nonetheless, we realized at that point in time, you know, whatever it means, there's something else in this house besides us. Now, it didn't seem to be, well, at least initially, okay, well, what does it mean? Is this something we should be concerned with? Is this going to be scary or whatever? And as time went on and it began to manifest itself in other ways, we'd come down in the morning and all the lights would be on. Or furniture would be moved. Or water would be running in the sink. Okay, after that happened, it didn't seem to be a big deal. It didn't seem to be anything that it was a curiosity we really needed to be concerned about. I told you about the furnace. I didn't tell you that there was 2 tons of coal in the basement. They didn't ever told the coal company that they got a gas furnace, I guess, and they delivered coal. So how cold it was, I put in a wood coal burner in the basement that winter because we weren't going to use kerosene heaters like the previous owners did. And got it all set up and started to burn that coal and wood as well. So every morning I would go down to the basement to check on that little furnace. And every morning in this room where the furnace was, the light would be on, the radio would be playing, and a chair that I had at a workbench would be positioned in front of that stove. And it was like clockwork. So again, we became not numb to it. We just, okay, put the chair back, turn the light, turn the radio off, forget about it. Didn't seem to be anything that was going to hurt us. And as the longer we stayed there and as the kids got older, they would tell us, you know, things knocking on their doors at night or doors opening, and wasn't a night would go by, one of them wasn't in bed with us, we all came to realize that, you know, we lived in a haunted house for whatever that meant. Casper the Friendly Ghost, okay? It's no big deal, really. We didn't advertise it. I did tell my mother about it. And she said, why don't I arrange to have Father Victor, who was a priest at St. Sylvester's Church, come and bless your house? I said, hey, that sounds good. So she set it all up, and Father Victor came to the house, and he had his thing of holy water, and, you know, he's doing this, and it's kind of a joyous event. And I'm thinking, okay, this might just take care of it. You know, he's saying different prayers, and we're going through the second floor of the house, and, you know, there's 5 bedrooms on the second floor, and these are big bedrooms, big spacious bedrooms, all have their own big fireplace and mantle, and 3 bedrooms in the back of the house and 2 in the front. And this one in the front of the house we gave to my oldest son, Bobby. I later would find out that the people who lived there for 40 years had quit using that room as a bedroom, that there were issues with that room. She didn't go into detail, but that's the room we gave to our son. And
He wouldn't sleep in the bed. He slept in the closet on the floor with the light on, and we just thought, well, that's, he's a little kid, he's frightened, put a crib mattress on the floor, and that's where he slept. But I said that to say, it was strange, as we were walking down the hall that morning, or that afternoon with the priest, it was Saturday afternoon, and he was coming to that room to bless it, going in every room, my three-year-old son darted in front of our group and stood in the doorway like this and looked the priest dead in the eye and said, you can't come in this room. Can't come in this room. It was like, I don't know what was going on with him and what caused him to do that, a three-year-old. It was just odd. And the priest just said, oh, don't, he threw holy water on the door and we went by. Now, later on, as we would discover what took place in that room, the significance of that room, it made sense. As the years went on and more facts came out as this paranormal activity escalated, it became more clear, like a big puzzle that you're putting together and you're getting the pieces in. So we lived there, through, this was the end of the 80s into the early 1990s, and we're dealing with this spooky stuff. Again, okay, we'll live with it. Didn't seem to be a big deal. But I found out, later, that there is a difference between ghosts. You believe in ghosts. I believe in ghosts. Now, why there are ghosts, I don't know. Ghosts are the spirits of people who once lived. And generally, their death, some tragedy, some sorrowful incident is associated with their demise, their dying, and they're reliving something, part of their life. They're in one house or one place and they haunt that place, and they, are they in purgatory or something? It's generally not a nice thing, but ghosts are, the spirits of people. But I also found out that a lot of spirits that sometimes masquerade as ghosts are not ghosts, and they're not human spirits. They're demonic spirits. There's a lot of demons around us. And for whatever reason, sometimes these things possess places. They can possess objects, they can possess buildings or rooms, and they can possess people. Now, a full-fledged possession of a person like The Exorcist is very rare, as I've come to understand. They will oppress people, they will follow them. A full-fledged possession is very rare. But the cases in which a demon will inhabit a house or a place, I'm not going to say it's common, but it does happen. And I get this, this information from the church. And, they have patterns of things that, a mode of operation. There are rules that they operate under. There's a hierarchy, almost like a military hierarchy. You have lower level demons, they're poltergeists and so on, and then as you go up, they become more powerful and more influential. And I know I sound like I'm crazy, but I'm telling you, I would later find out that this demon in our house was a higher level demon because of what had to be done to expel it, and what it did in turn to fight back. And only a demonic force of some strength would be able to deal with what I called at that point all the Catholic hocus pocus. I wasn't Catholic, we were evangelical Christians, we belonged to an evangelical Christian church right over the hill here for years, and I took my Bible to church, and I'm not denigrating or trying to say anything against any of that. I'm just saying that when it came down to it, and I'll explain to you in a moment how it happened, we only had one place to turn to for help. I wasn't able to pick up the phone and call Dan Aykroyd and Bill Murray and have their ambulance come. I wish I could have. That would have been easy. But no, what do? You go to the church. And I found out, I mean, I never prayed the rosary. It seemed, I mean, crazy, saying all these prayers over and over again, holy water and candles and crucifixes. It's all a bunch of hocus pocus, mumbo jumbo, dominoes and biscuits, that kind of stuff. Hey, I found out soon enough, stuff is powerful. And I came to rely on it. And we lived there day to day. It became part of an arsenal that we used to fight this thing. In the meantime, you know, it fought back. It was, you know, it would take crucifixes and break them in half. It would take pictures of Jesus and throw them on the floor. It would take rosary beads on a regular basis. I'll describe in a moment, but break them in half, chew up the crucifix. One time I was saying the rosary, for those who went to Catholic school, you remember the nuns wore those big black rosary beads that would hang down, and heavy duty things, they could hurt you with them. I was saying rosaries and they fell apart in my hands onto the floor. I'm not here advertising for the Catholic Church. I'm just saying that there's something to all that stuff, folks. And had I not had that to lean on, that tradition, that learning, it would went on my mind. It was tough. So when does it get bad? Well, it got bad before I realized it got bad. Because this thing, ultimately, its purpose was to drive us out of the house, to hurt us. And it focused initially upon my wife, who's here. And in 1996, she was very much involved in my political campaigns. I was a county commissioner by then. She had handled all of our finances. She was in politics herself. She was the president of the Brentwood School Board. She had it all together and was really a great help to me. And she came up with this idea of the master bedroom, and she wanted a big renovation project of this bedroom that involved the fireplace and all this stuff, and taking doors out, putting doors in. I knew with the time I had, it was going to be a number of months before I could finish all this work. So we simply moved all the furniture out of that room, and we moved in that one front bedroom where my son had been, whose personality was strange when he was a little kid. He was a very introverted, serious, troubled kid as a little, and again, didn't realize that that's just the way he was. Until we moved in that bedroom in right after I was elected county commissioner in 1996. And as the weeks went by and months went by, I noticed that my wife was like just kind of coming apart at the seams. And got to the point where she was just almost useless, just helpless. Ended up in July of that year, Allegheny General Hospital. She was in the lockdown psychiatric unit for 2 weeks straight. Under doctor's care and medication, she had a nervous breakdown, had no idea why. I thought, well, people, it just happens to people. People have issues, they have mental problems, okay, we'll have to deal with it. She came out under medication, doctor's care. Funny thing was, as I look back on it, we moved out of that bedroom. Within a month or two, she was fine again. Completely fine. And at the time, I never figured out what it was. Until later on, it went after my sons. Went after my oldest son first, went after my youngest son. Went through the same thing, Western psych, medicine, slit wrist, crazy, left school, and again, as this is happening, I just think I have a family of kids and a wife that have severe mental issues for whatever reason. Not only my wife, but then two of my sons. Until things really started to get crazy in the house. And when I left office in 2000, and was wrestling, my wife was fine by then, wrestling with these two sons that had severe mental disorders, and my wife, who had worked at Pitt, quit her job and came home to deal with them. It was a very stressful time. So we had a very, very serious public media incident where those two sons, they attacked me one night. It was bad. Police were involved, local media, newspapers. It just turned out to be a real hellish experience. And again, we're dealing with kids that have mental issues, and I end up in jail and all this stuff, and it was just a horrific event. So we go into to family counseling and so on, and by that time the paranormal activity in the house was ratcheting up. It was no longer a curiosity. It got to the point where I could see it was outright dangerous, and I started to put, I thought, two and two together that this stuff going on in the house has something to do with what's going on with the kids. And we were talking, and I went to the pastor of my church, and I said, "Pastor, I said, I'm telling you, there's something crazy going on in this house. We got furniture moving, stuff happening, and he looked at me and just thought I was, either delusional, overreacting. He said, "I think you're trying to come up with reasons to explain what's happening with your children. A lot of kids have, issues and so on." I said, "No, this is beyond that. There's something wrong with this house." And, he just blew me off. Which I don't blame him for. It did sound crazy. The first thing that happened that really got my attention, that concerned me, was one evening in my son was in his bedroom, and it was around dinner time. I was not home yet. I didn't come home from work yet. And he heard a loud pop over in the corner of the room. Not like a gunshot, but a real pop, like one of those pump-up air guns that you used to have. You could shoot and blow air. A real loud pop, he said, that sounded like air. And he felt something whiz right by his head and hit the wall. So he looked at the wall. He heard this thing smack into the wall, and then looked on the floor. And what it was a music CD. Okay, now, you think, a music CD, if you take one of those and you try to crack it in half, or if I even took it and I threw it like this against that wall, it probably would just chip it or crack it, and it would bounce off. This thing hit that wall, 1-inch plaster, with such velocity that it shattered into, you could hold the shards in your hand, 25, 20 pieces. Like a plate that had just been shattered. And when I saw that, I came home and Lisa said, "Take a look at this." Came out of the corner of Bobby's room and hit the wall beside him. I realized, this is serious. If that would hit him, who knows, it could have killed him, with that much energy. So what do you do? Who do you turn to? What do you do? Okay, so this is getting dangerous. It would get much more dangerous, but at that point, I wasn't sure who I was going to talk to. It's not like, as I said, you can just call somebody up. Maybe now you could. You have all these paranormal groups out there, but at that point in time, there was nothing like that. And
you know, I read my Bible, I said prayers and so on, and when I was in office as a county commissioner, every year around Christmas and Easter, every contractor that worked for the county thought that they had to give the commissioners, especially the chairman, a gift. So at Christmas time, I would get hams and I would get fruit baskets and I would get big baskets and candy and all this stuff every day coming into my you'll understand why I'm telling you this in a moment. So I'd get all this stuff into my office. The Steelers would send a basket literally that big, as they should have. And we would take, I took the beer out of it. And I said to my chief of staff, what am I going to do with all? I'm not taking this stuff home, you know. I could, you know, if I put it all after a week or so, I could fill the back of a pickup truck with it. I'd get a couple things a day. So he said, take it to the Passionist Convent. And I said, where's the Passionist Convent at? He said, you know, right there on Church View, at the top of Sankey Avenue. If you're familiar with Carrick and the top of in Maytide, you come up, go up Sankey, and there's this brick building there surrounded by a big wrought iron cast, metal, big fence. You know, it just sits there. And, you know, you never really knew what that place was. And when I was a little kid, my mother would say, that's a convent. There are nuns in there. They spend their whole lives there and they never leave. And I said, oh, why? What did they do? But it's a cloistered convent. I mean, they go there as young women, and they have a cemetery in the back, and they have, you know, a lot of them lived over 100 years old. So, you know, they're there for a long time, happiest women you'd ever want to meet. But why did I say that? Because I started, okay, I'll take it. Where do I go? He said, you go up the steps, go through the gate, go up, there's a big door, go in, ring the bell. So I had a couple of these baskets, and I took them up one night after work, opened the door, and I walk in, just a big oak door, and there's a little screen with a cloth over it. So I ring the bell, and I don't see anybody. I hear behind the, can I help you, please? And I said, I have gifts for the sisters. Okay, thank you. Just put them here. And all of a sudden, this big metal turnstile opens up. It's kind of like the Addams Family or something. You know? I put the stuff in there, and it closes. And then it opens again, and they take it. So I did that for a matter of weeks. And then one day, the door opened, and it was the Mother Superior, and she said, I have to thank you. What you've done and what you've given the sisters, it's so exciting. And they're so happy, and please, will you come back on Christmas Eve, and they'd like to meet you. The rules said they can meet people at Christmas time. So we did, and I said all that to say that through the years, I started to go to Mass there. I still wasn't Catholic, but I went to Mass there on Saturday mornings. They have a little chapel. And I became very close with a couple of the sisters who were in charge. So they called me up when I left office, and I always said, hey, anything I can do to help you? And she said, you've always made an offer to help us. Will you come over? I have a project for you. So I went over. They have about 5 acres that you can't see from the street, and it had grown into a jungle over the decades. And she had about a year's worth of work for me. It's kind of like that movie, Lilies of the Field, if you remember Sidney Poitier building the chapel. I built them a grotto of Blessed Mother and outdoor stations of the cross. So I'm saying all this to say, that's who I called. And I called up the Mother Superior, and I started to explain to her, listen, I need some help. I need some advice. And she had mentioned to me she had been a missionary nun in Central America. She was younger and had experienced, you know, voodoo and all that kind of stuff. So she said, it sounds to me like you have an infestation of your house. She was very, very straightforward. She said, you need some priests from the Passionist Monastery. You should contact them and they'll help you. Oh, I've really run over. Okay, let me speed this up. I'm sorry. Okay, so I eventually get a priest to come, and Father Ed Moran, and he comes and he does prayers and he says Mass and goes through this whole process. I'm thinking, okay, this is going to fix it. Well, it didn't fix it. It got worse. So then eventually we have two priests coming. As the more they did, the more they had Mass, it was like this thing would have temper tantrums. I mean, it would move the furniture. It would take these big pictures on the wall and turn them sideways. And I mean, it just got crazier. And I'm thinking, this is supposed to help. It's not helping. So that went on for 2 months. And I still am close friends with Tom Murphy, mayor of Pittsburgh. And he knows my boys good. We used to go on canoe trips and so on. So he knew what I was facing, and he knew I wasn't crazy. And he said, what's going on? How's it going? And I said, it's not good. He said, let me go see Bishop Worrell. I'll go see Bishop Worrell. He could just go right in and see Bishop Worrell. So I said, great. You know, Bishop Worrell come with the hat and all that stuff. Maybe he'll be able to do something. So he called me up, and he said, okay. Tonight at 7 o'clock, you're going to get a call. Priest is going to call you and he's going to talk to you. And I said, okay. He said, just be there to answer the phone. So 7 o'clock that night, phone rang, and answered the phone. Voice on the other end of the phone. I mean, I'm thinking, you know, this is going to be some kind of real exorcist guy. Well, who it was, many of you might be familiar with him, is Father Ron Langland. He is the spokesperson for the Catholic Diocese. He's had a radio program on KDK for 35, 40 years. I thought to myself, well, this isn't the guy. He must just be calling on behalf of the bishop. But the more he talked to me, he's a very, very peaceful, settling voice that talks like this, you know, and he's telling me things about the house. What went on there? He's starting to tell me about, okay, there's a room at the top of the steps. You get to the top of the steps, and to your left, not the bathroom, which is a hard left, catacorners from where you're standing, there's a room there, right? Yes. And it has blue wallpaper in it. Yes. He goes, that room has a lot of problems to it. I said, how do you know, as he began to tell me this stuff, I said, like, this guy must be working some kind of script. He must have some kind of file on this house. And that went on. And he'd hang up and call back and, you know, tell me more. And finally he said, probably the second or third call, after he's telling me all this stuff about the house, and always in little snippets and without any real sense of direction. But he finally said to me, you have a decision to make. And that decision is, you can sell this house, just put it on the market and sell it, and hope for the best with whoever buys it, and move away and forget about it. Or, if you choose to confront this, the church will stand with you. And this is what really got me. He said, in a year we'll know if we're making progress. Now, I certainly wasn't up to here. I figured you just come and take care of this, you know, do what you do, you know, bring the smoke filled cans and, you know, whatever. Well, he said it isn't that easy. Wish it was, but in this case it isn't that easy. So I said, okay, we're in. What we were in for, I had no idea. And you'd say, well, why didn't you just get the hell out of that place? I mean, that's what I hear all the time. Why did you sell it? Well, you know, I'm not up to, you know, being forced out of my house. Two, we had a faith in God that, okay, good overcomes evil. And three, I couldn't, in all good state of mind and conscience, give this problem to somebody else. Now, clearly it was, for whatever reason, it got bad with us, real bad with us. I don't know why, but I couldn't. This was our problem. We owned it, so we had to stay with it. And a year from when he talked to me, it hadn't gotten any better. It had gotten a lot worse. And it wasn't another year from that point where we came anywhere near a resolution.
So I would say that as time went on, and I could talk and talk and talk about what we experienced and, you know, about how it would attack us physically and bite us and scratch us and knock your feet out from under you as we're going down the steps, and the manifestations, how it would appear in different forms and different bodily shapes, not only to me but the kids, and how it possessed the two bedrooms, that one room I told you about, and our master bedroom. We had to move all the furniture out of those rooms. Couldn't use the room because it would be in there. Now you'd say, how do you know it was in there? Well, the way it would manifest itself on a daily basis to me, and I'm almost done because it's just too much detail. I call it a pillar of stench. Now, this thing had a smell to it that was a combination of a burning, like, rubber and sulfur. You know, sulfur from when you gunpowder or fireworks, that kind of stays in your nostril, mixture of this smell. It would not permeate the entire room. You know, you go into a room and spray air freshener, and you could smell it in the room, or roses or so on. It was like if you're next to somebody who stinks, you know, has bad breath, or has body odor. I know it doesn't happen too often, but you know you only smell it when you're like right next to them. You move away, you don't smell it. So you walk into the room, and all of a sudden you're hit with this stinking stench. And by that time, okay, I had a handle on what we did, how we would confront this thing. So if it's right here, my wife would be with me most of the time, and we would either be saying the rosary, interactive together. Okay, I'd hit it with holy water. It would be, and it would move. So I'd walk. You really weren't sure where it went to until you hit the smell again. Hit it again. And I would go through that process to try to drive it out of that particular room on a nightly basis. That was that part of the struggle. And again, you're saying, this is crazy. It's nuts. It was. I didn't want to come home at night. I had to deal with this thing. I had daily rituals I would go through. I would say prayers in the morning. I would say prayers at night. I would say the rosary. Every night I would go to bed with my rosaries in my hand, and I'd wake up every morning, and the same thing. The rosary beads would be put together like this in three or four different places where the little links would be fused together. They wouldn't be bent, they wouldn't be broken open, they would just be fused together. And I would have to take little jewelry pliers and pry them apart and pick, because then when they're together, I can't pray them. And you would think, well, you know, you're laying on them or something. No, I wasn't. You know, I tested it. I would take rosaries with me when I'd go away on business, and it would never happen when I wasn't in the house. One particular time, I had a set of rosaries my mother gave me, crystal rosaries from Medjugorje, had a silver cross, and the crucifix on the bottom of it was like five metal teeth, and I chewed it up like a toothpick. That's what it would do. As I said, break crucifixes in half, you'd find them laying on the floor. It liked to take our wedding picture too and throw it on the floor every day. One of the things we finally determined was really powerful. If you can remember 10 years ago or so, and that's when this was happening, the movie The Passion of the Christ, Mel Gibson's movie The Passion of the Christ. We put that movie on in that front bedroom, and had the DVD player, could put it on retreat, played that movie 24 hours a day for over 6 months until the player literally just broke. And we would come in, and the TV would be turned off, the DVD player would be turned off, or even the DVD would be out on the floor. It wasn't broken, but it would be out of the player. Finally figured out how to get it out of the player. My wife finally took a full-length body mirror and put it in front of the TV set so there was no place in that room where you couldn't see what was being depicted. That movie was powerful, and I think it's testimony when I was talking about unmasking evil, what's happened to Mel Gibson since he made that movie. I mean, he was like the most popular person in the world at one point, and
after he made that movie, he like lost his mind. I don't think he was prepared for the backlash. So, anything that had to do with representations of Jesus and his crucifixion was a weapon. And eventually it would leave puddles of this fluid on the hardwood floors. And in the book, as I detail, in January of 2005, a year later, when we were basically played out, I mean, I was done. I mean, I was ready to lose. I mean, it was bad. Our kids were bad, everything. We had spent a year fighting this stuff, and it wasn't any better. I was ready to give up. I was like Rocky, you know, trying to pull myself up on the ring ropes, stand back up again. We were knocked out. And at that point in time, I think it realized it, and what it would do, it would mimic, it mimicked what the priest did. Now, when the priest would go through with holy water, as I said, and they did it all the time, go through not only the house, but the yard too, and throw holy water on the walls. And you can imagine, you know, drops of water hitting the walls running down. If you can think taking that same container that had the holy water in it and filling it with blood and taking that and throwing it on the walls, that's what it did. So I come home, the third floor, the whole walls are covered with these red drops of fluid running down. What in the world is this stuff now? You know? Not just a little thing, I mean all over the place, even up on the ceiling. And yes, I had it tested. I had it tested by one of the best labs in the country. One lab initially tested to see if it was anything natural, anything. Now, it's drops, but is it something that occurred naturally? Is it some kind of mold that seeped out? No, nothing natural. This is a fluid. So, okay, what does it consist of? It's not blood. It certainly looked like blood. So they broke it down into the different components. And it was like stuff that had no sense, rhyme, or reason to be mixed together. It's not like they say, well, this is, you know, cherry pop, cherry soda, or Mr. Clean, or something. No, it was like a sulfur, it had sulfur in it, it had carbohydrates in it. The guy said to me, it's like maybe half of it was a food substance, and half of it was cleaning fluid. And I don't know what it is. And they certainly couldn't tell me how it got on the walls. So yes, but, you know, and I actually have I initially had taken samples of it on Q-tips to have it analyzed, and then I was told if you can get it in a pure form. So I took it off some glass and I scraped it when it dried, so I had it in like a powdery form. But initially I had taken like a Kleenex or a paper towel, and I have, you can look at it, this is some of it right here. It still has a red tint to it. I shouldn't even have this. Because we were told to burn it all. And I'm just about done. As I said, it would take different forms. Mainly to the kids, it would appear in these different grotesque, most often it looked like the Grim Reaper. Like it would have this cloak, you know, cynical looking face. They would see it in bodily form. I saw it, would experience it most often as that stench. But I did get a picture of it at one point. Our dog and our cat could see it, especially our dog, who was part golden retriever. It would sit in front of rooms and just stare, like point, and then it would start to bark and growl. And I knew it was looking at something. So the same day I'm upstairs taking pictures of this stuff on the wall with a camera, before cell phone cameras, and I'm coming down, and I look down the steps, I'm on the landing, and the dog's looking at me, and he has his what I call terminal stare. He's not looking at me, he's just staring. So I held the camera in front of myself, just like that, I took a picture. Nothing to it, I didn't see anything. A couple days later, my wife calls me up from the car and said, you took a picture of Sandy from the steps? He goes, she said, you're not going to believe this picture. Anyway, you can see this closer, but here I was right in the middle of this thing. And it looked kind of like a misty, ghosty skeleton. All like these little bones, or maybe it was a hand or something. But I was right in the middle of it at the time. Okay, so we finally went through this long process. I mean, we had,
these investigators come from Penn State University, these students, paranormal researchers, came twice. They did all the tape and all the instruments, and they verified there's crazy stuff going on in that house. And the Catholic Church needed that because they have to build a case anytime there's an exorcism of a person or a place. It has to be very meticulously documented. So we finally got a very renowned exorcist to come to the house in late 2005. He performed a 3 or 4 hour exorcism of the house with it was an older priest and a younger priest, like in the movies, and didn't completely deal with the issue. It was still some months later before it was finally played out. That was when we had Mass in the basement. It seemed to be confined to the basement after the exorcism. And it finally didn't end with a bolt of lightning or thunder or anything impressive. It just was a fire that burned itself out. We were told that it would periodically, we would have echoes. Things would happen every few months for a number of years, and certainly things did happen every now and then. Those instances of things happening have, I'll say, just about stopped completely. I would say, I've been saying that we didn't have anything happen since last year until last week. But again, it's nothing like it was. I mean, we dealt with this stuff on a daily basis. It was like, living in some kind of a crazy place. And I'm saying all I said to tell you that this was evil. It verified itself as being evil because it was repulsed by anything that represented something that was holy. And it tried to hurt us, tried to hurt us mentally, it hurt us physically. It demonstrated how much it detested anything to do with the cross. And I came away a very, very firm believer in this stuff. I don't have it all figured out like I thought I once did. And as I think a lot of people think they have it all figured out, but it's true. And I think when you realize it's true, it forces you to look at life in a different way. And when you realize that, it's all, the good and evil, the devil, that's it. I'm convinced of it. I lived it. I experienced it. And that's why I had to write this book, to tell that story. So the book is truly a story of faith, perseverance, and overcoming evil through the power of the cross of Jesus Christ. And you would say, well, how did you have the courage to face this and go through with it? Well, after so long, I realized we could confront it. We could make this thing's existence just as, I think, miserable as it was making ours. And, as I say, if a big bear came in here, we would all run. We would be scared. But if I had a .30-06, I wouldn't be as scared if it came. So when I'm dealing with this evil, once I had those weapons, you could fight back. I had protection. I had a means to an end. And I was convinced that eventually that we would prevail, and that God would prevail, and we did. And that's the story. That's the book, and thank you very much for having me. And I'd be happy to take any questions you might have and sign books if you have them. Anything, any questions? 1, 2, 3, anything? Yes? They're okay now. Our oldest son, Bobby, who's on the cover of the book, I can say that the past 10 years haven't been easy for him. He ended with a lot of scars and a lot. He's had a rough time, and but he's doing well now. He's married, has a couple kids,
The other ones are doing fine. Charlie, the youngest one, who also had a lot of the issues, he lives in Florida, just came home with his fiancée to visit us. I guess he's getting married next month. You know, kids don't get married and live together. They live together first, then they get married. So. You know, people say that, you know, I think it was just, it was one. It was one very powerful. Now, did we have other spirits in the house? Did we have ghosts and so on? You got to read the book to understand what went on there in the past. I mean, we had four people buried in the front yard that were killed. Three little girls and their mother are buried right in the front yard. I believe that was what initiated this evil that attached itself to the land, and then when the house was built, inhabited the house. And that's in the book. Yeah, we can talk afterwards. Yeah, that's, this stuff is nothing. It's, you know, it's not, it shouldn't be somebody's hobby. I mean, people go out and they try to, you know, if they come across one of these evil things, I mean, it can hurt you, you know. The spirit of it, yeah.
And he has a really couple good CDs, you know, protection and, mm-hmm. and how to fight, you know, the dark thing, you know,
all that. I usually, and again, I usually read my epilogue, and I've gone too far, but there's an epilogue that I write and how this has changed, how it's changed me. And, you know, my whole outlook on faith, and as I said, at one point in time, I had things all, you know, had the Bible, and you got all the answers, and I realized it's not that cut and dry, but, you know, going through this wasn't easy. Like I said, it was kind of like the Matrix. When Father Ron was talking to us about making the decision of stay or stay, it was like, you know, take the red pill or the blue pill, if you've seen that movie. Take the red pill and wake up in your bed tomorrow and you won't remember any of this, or the blue pill, you'll go down the rabbit hole. We went down and... Anything else? Thank you. Yes. What people are that?
Well, Bishop World.
Yeah.
Cardinal
Yeah.
So, and I know you're going across the country. I know other people don't know how trouble with angels.
Yeah.
And that's what scares me.
Well, I mean, the Catholic Diocese of Pittsburgh went to the media about this book, you know, long before it was published. I mean, it wasn't published till August. They went to the media in like a year ago in January. They wanted to get out in front of it because they knew it was going to be somewhat controversial. So the church, Bishop Zubik, went on TV to, you know, they stand behind it and say this all happened. And I know there was an article in the Post Gazette, Sunday Post Gazette front page, where some of the family members of the people that sold us the house and so on said, I mean, I have no reason to make this up. I mean, I didn't use their real name. It's a fictitious name. And I don't blame the people for wanting to leave the house and sell the house. They thought that they had taken care of it. Now it's time to go. So, you know, I would have no reason to say that they sold us a house. I truly believe they knew what we were, that there was issues. And yeah, you're right. Thank you. Yes, sir.
I grew up on Stewart Avenue.
Yeah.
And about a block from your house, on the opposite side of Ronald.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the house.
I used to walk out of Bremen Park and I would walk on the opposite side.
Yeah. Well, those, they're linked. The whole story is linked. Yeah, what happened? Yeah, absolutely. And I've talked to the people, and I didn't even really mention that in the book, because people live there. I've talked to them, and it's all connected. This whole story is connected, and what took place, and the backstory, and the doctor who was involved, who I didn't even use the doctor's name. The Post-Gazette put his name in the paper, and they verified most everything that I said. The reporter did. And, I mean, we just gave him didn't even give him a name. We just called him Dr. M. So, yes?
I have a question. I have two questions. Are you a practicing Catholic yet?
Yes. Yes.
My other question is, I did read the book, okay? And I don't have another question to ask you later.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you have to understand, if you understand that war, that was the first major war that the United States was involved in after the Revolutionary War. It was a war with the American Indians. Got our clocks clean. I mean, the American Army got, I mean, St. Clair, he was a general. I mean, they got wiped out a couple times. What happened was, after we won the revolution, when the British owned this territory, no one was allowed to settle in Ohio or west of the Alleghenies. And once the United States got all the land and got Ohio and Michigan and Indiana, they opened it up, the country opened it up for settlement, and in fact paid soldiers and people they owed money to with land. So all of a sudden you have this wave of people going into Ohio in the late 1880s. Well, the Indians, the American Indians, said, hey, this is our land. We didn't sign the Treaty of Paris, you know. The English say they gave the land to you. It's our land. They recognized it was our land. That's why they wouldn't let anyone come here. Well, all of a sudden you had this war. There were more American soldiers killed during that war than all of the soldiers killed in all the wars out in the West with the Sioux and the Apache and everything. So it was a war of terror. The Indians generally wouldn't kill women and children. They'd either take them hostage or put them in their tribe. Well, in this case, it was a war of terror, and they wanted to send a very strong message to settlers that you come here, we're going to kill you and your family. So they did that. So to answer your question, I think it's not unlike the evil that I talked about earlier with what's going on with ISIS. It's evil is behind, we're making people do really horrendous things. So we think that whatever evil spirit it was that perpetrated that crime against those three little girls and their mother attached itself to the land. And I had a woman come to me, I think it was a Dormont library. It's funny how much I learned from just talking to people from Pittsburgh. And she said, you know, one morning years ago, I lived in Carrick, and I was walking down early one Saturday morning. I was walking right by your house, and I saw an older woman standing right at the end of, like, the yard, and she was dressed like in a bonnet and a long dress that went down to the ground and like an apron. And I walked up to her to kind of talk to her. She looked so out of place to ask her if she lived in the house or whatever. She said, as I closer I got to her, I realized I could see through her. And by the time I walked to her, she disappeared. So she was obviously that woman that, again, okay, it's, I'm sounding really crazy now, but go ahead. Anything else? Anyone else? Yes, yes, sir. Well, okay, this is the story, because we did this too. What one of the blessings of the land and the thing is you take a holy object and you bury the holy, the rosaries, the crucifix, the cross, at the four corners of the property. And then the priest will bless everything. And we ended up doing that too. And you bury holy objects in the four corners as claiming it for God. So when Mr. McHenry said, please just put it back, I could only surmise that the priest that had the mass in the living room had gone through that process to tell him to bury rosaries and holy objects at the four corners of the property. And from his response, not only then, but I years later called him to talk to him, and I asked him if we could meet after we had a very pleasant conversation about the house for about 20 minutes, and I said, we've experienced some real strange things in the house over the years. Can we get together and talk? And he said, I'll get back to you. Hung up the phone. I never heard from him again. So he didn't want to talk to me. So. I always do this because I have to, because I'm just very, very focused upon making sure that I don't take any credit for this personally, that I put credit where credit is due. And I'll just read the end of this. I feel privileged to have been given the opportunity to experience the supernatural firsthand, to understand that demons, angels, Jesus, the devil, all exist just as described. I've seen it, smelled it, and witnessed its power. My faith has been verified and confirmed just as I have seen Jesus walking on the water, feeding the 5,000, or raising a person from the dead. It's all real. The Bible states, for unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required. And that's why I had to write this book and tell this story. And I end with this scripture from the book of Isaiah. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. So with that, the protection that we were given did in fact stay with us and enable us to deal with this. And that's my goal, is to tell that story and to put credit where credit is due. And if it's a story for the time, I think it is. As this story, you know, I do interviews, and you know, it just grows. And I think once the television programs are aired, it's just going to give it that much more credibility. And I know it's probably closing time. Anything else? Okay. Thank you very much, and I'd be happy to sign any books.